I challenge the reader to engage in a deep form of skepticism, challenging our fundamental notions of what matter is, what physicality or the whole category of the physical is, and together with this, challenge many of our deepest assumptions within the scientific community and elsewhere about the nature and origins and potentials of consciousness and the role of consciousness in the universe. Mainstream views that dominate academia, really quite worldwide, insist that everything in the universe really consists of space, time, mass, energy, and the emergent properties that arise from mass and energy, the functions, the emergent properties, the characteristics of mass and energy, hence the term physicalism or scientific materialism. The assumption underlying this view is that what is absolutely out there, independent of our human concepts, independent of our measurements, really is precisely this: space, time, mass, and energy. What people often fail to recognize, however, is that the very category of the physical, of the mental, is a category that we humans have constructed, and we've not only constructed, but we've reconstructed over the last 400 years, and in fact much longer, but over the last 400 years of science. We have created, we have devised, based upon our modes of observation, of measurement, of experimentation, exactly what the parameters of the physical are. What is matter? What is not matter? These are human definitions, and these human definitions have evolved as science has evolved. The physical, matter, is precisely what the physical sciences are good at measuring. But the category, once again, is a physical construct. So the notion that everything in the universe must fit into a construct that we human beings have devised, and then insisting, moreover, that everything in the entire universe must fit into a construct as we have devised it now, that is, the 2009 version, strikes me as really being a form of idolatry. Just as the ancient Jews had the golden calf, something they created and then worshipped, likewise we've created the golden calf of the physical, the matter, virtually worshipping it as the source of all of reality, the source of all goodness, the source of all happiness. But as a construct, it's a type of idolatry. And frankly, I think it's absurd to believe that everything in the universe fits into some construct that we have created based upon the types of measurements we human beings have been engaging in for the last 400 years. It is rather pretentious. So I'm suggesting that in this book, that we look beyond this single category of the physical, since after all, space itself is not composed of mass energy, time is not composed of mass energy, and perhaps very importantly, mathematical equations, the laws of nature, they too do not consist of space, time, mass, or energy. And yet who can deny that these mathematical principles, these mathematical laws of nature do exist? But they are not physical. So as I proceed in the book, then I challenge the reader to reassess also the nature of consciousness. Thus far, mainstream science overwhelmingly has assumed that consciousness simply emerges in some as yet inexplicable way from complex configurations of chemical compounds engaging or interacting with electricity. But no one's proposed exactly how this occurs. No one has proposed with any degree of confidence or any empirical confirmation when, in the evolution of life on this planet, consciousness first arose and what were the conditions for its arising. Nor do we know in the development of a human fetus inside the mother's womb, nor do we know when consciousness first emerges or what are the necessary and sufficient causes for it doing so. We simply assume that somehow consciousness must simply emerge from matter. And why? Because we're very good at observing matter. We're very good at observing, investigating, running experiments on configurations of mass and energy. But the whole of science over the last 400 years has never devised any sophisticated means for directly observing states of consciousness, the mind, mental processes. Especially over the last century, the overwhelming majority of scientific inquiry into the nature of the mind has always been indirect, focusing on what scientists are good at looking at: the physical, the objective, the quantifiable. So certainly scientists, cognitive psychologists, neuroscientists, will interrogate others about their subjective experience, but as one cognitive psychologist recently commented, we do not take other people's reports of their subjective experience as facts. We simply take them as reports, as data. The same cognitive psychologist claimed, all of our subjective experience consists of hallucinations. So we are to rely then more upon the metaphysical principles of materialism than we are upon our own immediate experience, as if our own immediate experience doesn't count, and we should rely rather on the scientists' observations as if they have some special access, and upon their metaphysical assumptions that everything must boil down to matter and the emergent properties of matter. This mindset of dismissing or marginalizing first-person experience and insisting that metaphysical principles, the appeal to authority of a certain community, is exactly the mindset of medieval scholasticism. It is exactly the mindset that the pioneers of the scientific revolution revolted against. It is said that scholastic philosophers in particular, refused to look through Galileo's telescope or comparable telescopes because they were sure before they looked that if they saw anything that refuted their own metaphysical assumptions based on the Bible or based upon Aristotle and other Greek thinkers, if they saw anything that refuted what they believed to be true, they were sure that what they were seeing must be a hallucination and therefore didn't need to be given any credence. It could be dismissed, marginalized. That's exactly the attitude of many cognitive scientists today. If you witness anything as you observe your own mind that violates the principles of scientific materialism, you must be observing a hallucination. Your direct observations of your own mind don't count. And in fact, cognitive psychologists, cognitive neurophysiologists, advise no means of observing any mental state whatsoever. They leave it in the hands of amateurs, but then say the amateur's reports are not factual, they're simply what the amateur said. So we are now in a situation with respect to consciousness, and in fact to the mind, comparable to what medieval natural philosophers were in the early 17th century. A massive and very powerful church. But some people, such as Galileo, who are true empiricists, and insisted that what we perceive with our senses as we look into the night sky, observe the sun, moon, planet, and stars, if we see something directly, especially using sophisticated means of observation, that overcomes the assumptions or refutes the assumptions of medieval scholasticism, those assumptions have to go, and we will rely primarily upon experience. This is the view of Buddhist contemplatives and other contemplatives around the world. We will rely primarily upon immediate experience of the nature of the mind, of states of consciousness, and we will probe the space of the mind as astronomers have probed physical space, the space of the universe. And so Buddhist contemplatives and others have found multiple dimensions, have found a dimension of consciousness that lies beneath our ordinary psyche, the conscious and subconscious minds, called the substrate consciousness, which is blissful, luminous, non-conceptual, and does not arise from matter, does not arise from neuronal activity in the brain, does not arise from matter of any kind. It's not material, it does not arise from material, it is conditioned by matter, but does not arise from matter. A deeper dimension of consciousness. Those who have accessed this substrate consciousness, this subtle continuum of mental consciousness, have used this as a platform, rather like launching a Hubble telescope beyond the atmosphere of our planet to be able to probe into deep space beyond the distortions of the atmosphere, of contamination in the atmosphere, light pollution and so forth, enabling them to probe much more deeply into the space of the universe. Likewise, those who have launched their minds into orbit, into the substrate consciousness, have used this as a platform for probing even more deeply into the nature of reality as a whole, and not only the reality of their own individual mental continua. They've discovered a whole dimension of reality called the form realm, which is more subtle than our constructs of matter and of mind at a coarse level, a deeper dimension of reality out of which this dualistic reality of mind and matter, subject and object, emerges. A form realm. We find a comparable notion, a hypothesis from the writings, the collaborative writings of Carl Jung and Wolfgang Pauli, one of the greatest psychologists, one of the great physicists of the 20th century, who propose an unus mundus, a unitary reality that transcends, that underlies this coarse physical reality of mind and matter on this coarse level. Buddhism goes beyond this to propose that all phenomena are empty of any inherent nature or identity of their own. All phenomena arise relative to the means by which the phenomena themselves are apprehended. So perceptual phenomena, such as sounds and colors, smells and tastes, all arise and exist only relative to the sense perceptions of them. They do not exist independently out in the objective world or inside the brain. They exist only relatively in this interface between sensory perception and sensory objects. This is a truth widely known in modern neuroscience, modern physics, but the middle way view in Buddhism, this perfection of wisdom tradition in Buddhism, goes beyond this and suggests that all such things that we imagine to exist independently of perception, such as particles and fields, waves, space and time, these too are human constructs. We have defined them. And these constructs of particles, waves, matter, the physical, and so forth, these too exist only relative to the mind that conceives them. They do not exist independently in some absolutely objective universe. All these phenomena arise in a mode of dependently related events, a process of dependent origination, nothing having its own absolute or inherent nature. This view also finds its reflection or a parallel in modern quantum mechanics, in the writings of John Wheeler, of Anton Seilinger, of many others, physicists who probe so deeply into the nature of the physical world that they found that in fact we know nothing about the physical world as it exists independently of our systems of measurement, as it exists independently of our conceptual frameworks. All that we know of the universe is what the universe reveals to us in response to our questions and our systems of measurement. In other words, the very concept of matter is something that emerges from information, and information is what we glean from our systems of measurement, and there is no information without someone who is informed, without the observer, without consciousness. So now consciousness turns out to play a central role in the universe that we know of. When you take the principles of quantum mechanics and apply this to the universe at large, you come up with a field or a discipline called quantum cosmology, which suggests that if you do not introduce the observer participant into this scientific understanding of the universe, in fact, the entire universe is frozen. The problem of frozen time, the universe does not evolve, there is no change. There is no evolution of the universe unless you introduce an observer participant who separates the objective world from the subjective observer. The objective world there, out there, the physical, the subjective observer over here. Without that invasion into the fabric of reality, that intrusion into the fabric of reality, without the participant, the observer, superimposing the sense of now, relative to which then there is past and there is future, there is no time. It sounds like mysticism, but in fact this is a direct inference from the equations of quantum cosmology. This view bears a strong parallel with a view that is regarded by many as the pinnacle of Buddhist thought, called the Great Perfection or Dzogchen, in which beyond all these dualistic appearances there is posited a primordial dimension of reality that consists, that is pervaded by primordial consciousness, that is non-dual from an absolute space of phenomena, beyond relative space-time, which is indivisible from a primordial energy, an energy of consciousness itself, out of which all other forms of energy are derivative. A unitary reality, a reality of perfect symmetry, which consists of undifferentiated energy, space, consciousness. And only with dualistic grasping do we freeze this universe such that we find ourselves inhabiting a world of this and that, of congealed, crystallized objects, congealed, crystallized subjects. Remarkably similar to the view of quantum cosmology. The very notion that time itself is relative, that there is no absolute time, there is no absolute past, even the past rises relative to the types of questions we ask and the systems of measurement we devise in the present. The past only exists relative to the present. The future exists only relative to the present. The present exists only relative to the past and the future. None of these are absolute. Space is not absolute. Mind is not absolute. Can this be realized? The primary way of bringing this to immediate experience is through the practice of meditation, dissolving one's ordinary psyche, dissolving this like a snowflake melting into liquid water, dissolving the psyche into the substrate consciousness, using this as a platform for investigating into the very nature of the mind, using practices called vipassana, or contemplative insight, probing into the very nature of the mind to realize the absence of inherent nature of one's own mind, and then perceiving from this the absence of inherent nature of all phenomena, the emptiness of even the dualism of subject and object, and from that insight into the emptiness of all phenomena, then resting in profound inactivity until even the substrate consciousness dissolves, melts into primordial consciousness, pristine awareness, and one gains a non-dual realization that in fact one's own identity, the essential nature of one's own mind, has never been anything other than primordial consciousness, indivisible from the absolute space of phenomena, indivisible from the energy of primordial consciousness. One finally has come to know who one is, and one is non-dual from the ultimate ground of the entire universe, and one is awakened, and this is what it means to become a Buddha.